Yesterday. Well, it's no secret that since the coronavirus began spreading beyond China, countries like Kenya have faced numerous challenges, including currency depreciations, lost export earnings, and declining tourist revenues. But what are Kenya's options? Well, for that, we want to cross over to Geneva, the home of UNCTAD, the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, to speak to the Secretary General, Dr. Mukisa Kitui. Dr. Kitui, thank you for speaking with us this evening, and I trust that you are well in these difficult times.
Well, thank you, as well as under the circumstances.
Indeed. Let me get straight into it. Kenya and a lot of African governments find themselves in a catch-22 situation. On one hand, they can call for a full lockdown, but people may starve, insecurity may rise, etc. On the other hand, they could choose to continue with the status quo, and COVID will continue to spread unabated. Realistically, what can Kenya or any other African government do to weather this particular storm, in your view?
Well, first of all, I think we should avoid getting ourselves into a trap where we are trading off economic well-being and health well-being. What we can be discussing is it's absolutely necessary to save lives as fast as possible. But the cost of it is such that some people are too vulnerable. How can we cushion them? That is, we start addressing questions like easing the movement of food from production areas to markets, easing jobs that can be done online, facilitating e-commerce, for example, where possible. Three, reducing congestion in market areas. For example, you can decentralize the collection centers for food, whether it's Githurai or Kangeni, in a way that does not hurt the consumer who is vulnerable, but reduces the pressure for people to be congested together. So we should not start conversing as if it's either the vulnerable continue to work or they die. I think it is first and foremost the responsibility of everybody is keep as many people as possible alive. What can the state and friends of Kenya do to reduce the cost of exercising that?
It sounds like you have a middle way. I gave you two options, lockdown or continue with the status quo, but you say there's a way in which people can still continue to do business, but in a safe manner. Let's now talk specifics. For example, we know that the curfew and the way in which people are operating now in Kenya has devastated many small and medium-sized businesses, some of which might not recover. What are the different ways in which, in your view, they can be assisted to get back on their feet? Is there something like a government rescue package that our government here should be thinking about at this time?
Yesterday, I presented the thinking of UNCTAD to the world, saying one important thing that we cannot run away from, there is no part of the world which can recover from the COVID-19 without the rest of the world being recovered. So the developed countries find it in their own interest to assist developing countries also come. There are some specific recommendations that I'm making. The first recommendation, we have seen that the OECD countries, for example, have declared they're spending up to $5 trillion in cushioning their businesses, cushioning the vulnerable people in their countries, and try to ride out the tide, the recession that is following this crisis. Our argument is we need $2.5 trillion for the developing world. Where will this come from and what does it do? Number one, the IMF can have enhanced resourcing of special drawing rights to the tune of $1 trillion, which can be used both for stimulus support and for assisting governments keep small enterprises going, for example, through investing into consumer capacity, whether it is on soft loans or grants. The second is we need urgently an amount to the tune of $1 trillion again, which can be used for investing in support to health facilities. Look at it this way. The most immediate crisis for developing countries, including Kenya right now, the lack of capacity and equipment to test, to know how many people really are having the coronavirus infection. If you cannot test, you cannot trace which people have been reached by these people. If you cannot trace, you cannot isolate the infected. If you cannot isolate the infected, you cannot treat them. And if you are not treating, you are a sitting bomb. You're just waiting for the pandemic to explode on you. So the world has the ability to have a health financial plan as a first step. But secondly, to have an economic underlying program to do unto the developing countries what the developed countries are being able to do for themselves. Now, this is not asking for any new serious money. If you compute the ODA pledges that developed countries, OECD countries, will give 0.7% of the GNU, the gross national product, GNP, to development assistance, which they have not been doing. What they have not provided over the last 10 years is sufficient to cover the emergency requirements for now.
Dr. Kitui, those are some very good proposals that you've given, and we know that the G20 leaders met recently and agreed on that 5 trillion sort of economic lifeline for their countries as well. So you say Africa needs what, 2.5 trillion? How do you propose this begins? Because if you wait upon the IMF and the World Bank, I suspect that they are dealing with a lot of challenges from those who have traditionally backed them, some of the bigger and more advanced nations. Should African presidents get together and either through the African Union or some other way, begin to write and share some of these ideas? How would you propose this moves from being just an idea to a reality?
All right, it's not an idea. Yesterday, I addressed the ministerial meeting of the G20 trade and investment ministers. Mm-hmm. And IMF and World Bank committed at this meeting yesterday that they see gravity of the problem and are providing for resources to go into this program. Now, that means the first $1 trillion, which is from the enhanced drawing rights at IMF, can come through pledges and pressure to member states of IMF to provide. The second trillion can come from freezing servicing of foreign multilateral debt immediately, waiving interest on mature debt. This can sufficiently cushion countries from the amount of pressure that they are applied to service obligations under these difficult circumstances. There is another thing which countries can do at home. You know, you realize right now, because of the global emerging recession, portfolio investments are leading to a rapid capital flight. In our projections, just between February and March 2020, as much as $59 billion has fled from the poor countries from portfolio disinvestiture, dumping their investments. Now, compare this with the first half year after the crisis of 2008, when the total amount was $26.7 billion. So what are we saying? Governments may have to rethink applying capital controls to reduce this capital flight, which is not only putting pressure on currencies, but also putting pressure on the prices of African assets and developing country assets. So that is national level action. But African leaders can collectively strengthen their bargaining by speaking with one voice about the world needs Africa's ability to ride out this crisis for the world to be comfortable itself. That after so many economic migrants of the past 10 years, nobody wants health migrants around the world. And the best way to deal with it is to deal with it at home. Germany led by example, write off 50% of existing debt of weak countries as a way of contributing to this. It is not philanthropy, it is self-interest. But I think most importantly at home, and this is my main message to Kenyans, you are not inventing anything by having difficulties right now. We have the fortune and misfortune as a country that we have never had a serious emergency. So we don't know how to respond in this process of responding to an emergency in the country. For the population, look at how can we help each other. It is futile to waste too much time on political score settling. For the security apparatus, don't behave like zombies. It hurts me to see a policeman beating a driver of a truck delivering food to the urban poor. It's the responsibility of security apparatus to ease the pain of this difficult moment, not to act brainlessly, senselessly, physically assaulting citizens. And it's important for governments keep borders open, facilitate ports, help small business to work. Kenyans who have imported goods from China and are anxious about their arrival to go on.
Dr. Kitui, allow me to interrupt you on that. So you've given us really the bigger picture of what's happening on the continent and what different countries should be looking at. But let's go to the homestead level. As we speak right now, a lot of people watching this broadcast tonight have either lost their jobs, they're on unpaid leave. You've given some sort of wide-ranging measures that can help cushion the continent. But what can help cushion people at that homestead level today? They don't know where they're going to get their rent next month. They don't know where they're going to get their school fees when schools reopen. What measures can assist a person like that right now?
The first point to know is that this is a pricing that is not unique to Kenya. If you look at what has happened to the air travel industry in the world, total collapse everywhere. I was seeing today that American, the largest airline in the world, is asking for a $12 billion bailout from the US government. We have seen UAE, Emirates, has grounded 100% of its international flights. Those are representing unemployed people. It is true that there are people with pain. Government in a developing country has the possibility of doing better with its limited resources, but has no capacity to solve all the problems that arise from a fast shrinking and almost collapsing economy. So where we are, we should say, how can government of Kenya husband its limited resources so as to spread between helping to save enterprises so that they keep jobs going, but also to support those who are in informal sector and not dependent on formal employment. They will not do 100%, but with support of partners and judicious using of available resources and instruments, we can alleviate the pain that is inevitable and is happening. After the crisis, a lot of current enterprises will not exist again, not just in Kenya, around the world. New business models will have to come up. But the question should be, while we try to look to keep people safe from the health hazard, while we try to keep people alive by reducing the cost of a disrupted economy, how can our government prepare its people for rebuilding after the crisis? So we have to be in both gears, looking at the short term, keeping food on the table, reducing the hazard, and also thinking long term.
Dr. Kitui, we know that yesterday President Uhuru Kenyatta gazetted the board that will lead some sort of coronavirus relief fund. And at this time, as you monitor sort of what other countries are doing, what advice would you give that board that is sort of supposed to help in and really help sort the situation, even as National Treasury is struggling with the limited funds that we have to hold this country together at this time? What advice would you have for the board?
No. My position is this, that we can ask for philanthropy, people to donate part of their salary, for some friends to throw in some money. But to my mind, seeing the size of phenomenal pandemic that is facing the country, the first thing should be that budget should basically be radically transformed. The entire development estimates of government should now be devoted to confronting this phenomenon, building capacity to protect our health service providers, providing for more health facilities and space, buying ventilators, masks, and other necessary equipment, and supporting livelihoods for the vulnerable, the underemployed, the unemployed, and those with minimal returns. At this stage, I don't think it's enough to count on the philanthropy of people donating part of their salary. It is a good thing, but let us also devote substantial component of public budget entirely to ride out the next half year or so, and then we can start again. How do we rebuild after this crisis?
for the COVID-19 Emergency Response Fund Board, as much as they will be getting some donations in terms of philanthropy, you feel that the country's just total budget should be reconstituted to address the crisis that we currently face. There are those who say entities like, you know, Kenya Power, who have daily obligations that or monthly bills for consumers, that they should look at, in a way, pushing those for now. And also the issue of school fees. When schools reopen, many parents who had jobs before COVID-19 might not have jobs at that time. How do you deal with the day-to-day expenses that families in Kenya deal with, especially on a monthly basis?
You know, unfortunately, the state in Kenya has no capacity to babysit the nation. They can show their pain about the limits of the enterprises and government to deliver to the people of the country. But you have touched an important thing about utilities. You know, if you noticed last week, the Prime Minister of Britain nationalized British Railways, a conservative Prime Minister, reversing what nobody has done since Margaret Thatcher, privatized railways. Where we are today, if Kenya Power or any other utility company is still putting profit before service, the government of Kenya has a duty and a right to nationalize that company and consider utility as a service it can even offer for free in immediate terms to ease the pain that consumers and the citizens are confronting as they try to deal with this tragedy.
Dr. Kitui, even as we wrap up, there are those who say that the COVID-19, as devastating as it is, it provides a silver lining. It has, for example, in the Kenyan context, stopped the political bickering that had reached a crescendo earlier this year. And the others who say it is now time for Africa to look differently at how it trades with the rest of the world. Very optimistic views. Do you hold any of those views yourself?
Now, first of all, I do not see any silver lining on the pandemic that we are confronting right now. The pain that we have to go through as citizens, as people of the world, as developing countries, the fracturing of global production and supply networks, the decline of possible routes of selling things we've been selling. I have no idea if Kenya will be able to export anything under God to the US after this crisis, for example. There is such a large economic cost, I don't see a silver lining. But as it were, there's always a statement that nobody should waste a crisis is an opportunity. So I share the sense that if you see this crisis as an opportunity, it should be an opportunity to think afresh. And thinking afresh is not just about Africa in isolation. Africa needs the world. Africa needs international investment. Africa has to look to East Asia, which is going to be the main engine of recovery, because of the available greenfield surpluses more than anywhere in the West. We have to look beyond our traditional partners and build partnerships, but also importantly, the domestic productive capacity of Kenya, the ability to harness the ingenuity of Kenyans is something that we have to learn to embrace. And I'm counting on the ingenuity of Kenya as the big engine that will take us out of this crisis when the health hazard is over.
That Daktari, finally, you're in Geneva, Switzerland. What's the situation like there, and what sort of measures have they put in place that Kenya could or might not be able to sort of implement, even as we look at handling COVID-19 here?
I have been seclusion in my house now 18 days, including today. Geneva, 100% locked down, apart from pharmacies and food stores. Everything is totally shut down, and two people cannot walk out together in Geneva right now. Switzerland has the second largest per capita infection of the coronavirus in the world. But when government tells people stay home, it's inconvenient, but they stay home. And when two people stray onto the streets, the police do not beat them like animals. They come to them and tell them, you owe it to yourself and the rest of society to stay at home. I think the main lessons we learn from here are that people know we collectively have to do things that are not in our normal routine. We have to survive biologically to see how we rebuild our economies. But they have the resources here to cushion business. We don't have sufficient resources to cushion business in Kenya. What should we be talking right now? Should the people with low income who are going to be shuttered start moving to countryside like it's happening in India, or can we find a way of keeping them alive in the towns? Beyond night curfew, see how we decongest workplaces during the working day, which is an opportunity for the virus to be spread. Can we take those who are suicidal in their own behavior? How can we take them from the mainstream that they are mingling and dancing and acting as their lives don't matter? How can we stop their recklessness from having efforts to distance ourselves? I think these are lessons others have learned. And lessons, when you go slow, the price becomes higher. And I hope that my country, Kenya, can learn these lessons also.
Dr. Kitui, thank you so much for speaking with us tonight. And of course, lots of interesting questions that you've posed. I believe the Coronavirus Task Force and of course the Emergency Response Board that was also recently set up and government have listened to some of the suggestions and the questions and the thoughts that you have posed this evening on Newsnight. We are speaking to Dr. Mukhisa Kitui, the Secretary General of the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, live from Geneva in Switzerland. Well, we take a quick break. You're watching Newsnight. When we return, we've got some sports updates.